Hi, and welcome to the New Eat Report for the week of June 30th. I'm your astrologer, April Shaley. Very pleased that you're here. If you haven't subscribed to this channel, please do so you get to the notifications that this is posted as soon as it's done. And you can also go to my website at aprilsastrology.com to get your personal reading with me. And so we're going to cover what's going on for all of us right now and the intense aspect between Mars in Cancer and Pluto, who is in Capricorn right now, and it will be for years and years. Mars is kind of passing through Cancer a little bit slowly, but making this intense opposition aspect to Pluto. They're co-rulers of Scorpio. Scorpio has to do with all the stuff that we are the most interested in life, that we simultaneously hold in a taboo placement in society, and yet maybe the most sacred stuff there is. Those topics, those areas of life include sexuality, include the transition from life to death, or vice versa, the transition from disincarnate to incarnate. Scorpio has to do with regeneration. And death and rebirth, that whole dark goddess, the whole dark goddess thing, I'm trying to find the right words for that whole dark goddessness of the womb and the tomb, and those being that, this kind of the same thing in a way. Those are the sort of the places where life is generated and the place where life degenerates in preparation for the next the beginning of the next cycle. So Scorpio rules those kinds of cycles. Scorpio is basically the dark goddess. Scorpio is the underworld, and Lord Pluto, undercover for the dark goddess's animus, we could think of it that way, the male aspect of the dark goddess, the masculine aspect of the dark goddess. Lord Pluto is the modern ruler of Scorpio. Right? God of the underworld. His name means riches. Name means wealth. And Mars is the medieval ruler, the traditional ruler, the original ruler of Scorpio, and speaks to Scorpio's desire nature, speaks to Scorpio's sexuality and the impetus that Scorpio had, the impetus to penetrate the veil and penetrate into the mysteries that are beyond the five senses and that whole occulted area of life and death, which are really kind of the same thing when you're in that realm, when you're in Scorpio's world, right? So all these kind of mysteries, all the stuff that you can't talk about at the holiday table, like your latest orgasm or what's in your bank account or even politics, you know, politics is polite war, right? Power. You really can't just discuss power dynamics in polite company, right? Because that's going to upset people and it's very charged. So everything in life that's very charged is scorpionics, right? But it's the stuff that we want to know the most about. It's the stuff that we watch, you know, that this is the stuff that most, you know, dramas are about, that we watch on television or that movies are about, or any story that we really want to hear about deals in Scorpio material, right? So it's all the stuff that's the most charged and the most intimate and the part of ourselves that we like to generally keep private and keep hidden, which are privacy and shame are not the same thing, by the way, you know. Sometimes we just want private time, like when you go to the bathroom, you want it private. Doesn't necessarily mean you're ashamed of it, it's just time to have privacy. Or having sex with somebody doesn't necessarily mean you want to be out in public with this. Some people do, some people don't. Privacy, you know, things that, you know, what we want to keep to ourselves so that we can really feel safe, because Scorpio has a lot to do with emotional safety, you know, to explore and to reveal ourselves within a safe container, you know. And that's also Cancer. Cancer is that container itself. Cancer is the private life that we have and our family life, our home life. And Mars is in this sign right now. So Mars, when Mars is traveling through Cancer, there's this strong desire to protect our home and to take action in terms of creating family and maintaining family or protecting family. And Cancer is the right hand, or excuse me, in Mars in Cancer is like the right hand warrior archetype for the goddess, you know. So the two of them, Mars and Pluto, opposite one another, is gonna bring out our most unconscious but driven part of our natures. And this can be really super healing, or it can be really super stupid. It depends on how you want to go about dealing with it, right? So we're going to get triggered. Now here's something to know, is that Mercury came through just 2 days ago on the 28th. I'm recording this on the 30th. That was really triggering. That probably brought out some words, certainly some thoughts, you know, some intensity, some mental, super mental focus, may or may not have been on things that were really helpful to you, you know? One of the things that with this transit, with Pluto, Mars in general, and especially, you know, 2 days ago, that's dissipating, that's separating, Mercury's moving out of that position. So that's kind of, you know, that's a little bit of a relief. But the whole thing with Mars, Pluto is we may get this feeling like we really need to sink our teeth into something and not let go of it, because it's like life or death to make sure that this goes our way and that we have a position of a dominance in a situation where we feel really threatened. That's one manifestation of this aspect. And that's a signal that, you know, and that can go totally unconsciously. That can be like, you don't even realize you're doing it. It just feels like it needs to happen. It needs to happen now. These people are gonna, you know, do such and such to me if I don't win this battle, and I have to, you know, triumph, or I have to, there's like a have to piece to this aspect that may or may not be true. Because it may be coming from, you know, this is a signal that this is coming from, if there's something so intense for you, it's coming from an old ancient place in your reptilian brain where something perhaps early on could be infancy, could be early childhood. Again, Pluto's like ancient stuff, ancient reptilian, base of the spine, base of the skull, you know, kind of deepest emotional body cellular experience, you know, that's non-verbal, non-logical, but that drives us anyway, you know. And Pluto Mars is going to pull out all the stuff that needs to be healed around something that where we felt like we didn't get those primal needs met early, ancient times, you know. Could even be something inherited. I mean, it can be that intensive, where it's like, where is this even coming from? But usually, you know, it's not past lives. It's usually something that comes from our early childhood, and something that's happening currently has the same feeling tone, or is triggering the same feeling tone, has tripped up that complex within us, reactivated, lit it all up. And now we're reacting from that place, like, you have to love me, or I need that money, or, you know, I need to be this level of awesome, or I'm not lovable and I'm going to be abandoned. And, you know, I don't know, like things that are, again, that primal abandonment, survival, bonding, attachment, you know, what we try to get out of our current love relationships and our current family relationships, and even out of our work relationships, our jobs, our relationships to authority. Now we can have, you know, we can unconsciously be relating to, you know, our bosses and our landlords and people in authority as a parental figure that's, you know, tormenting us, or like, or needing to give us some, you know, I mean, this can have a million different ways of manifesting, and it all depends on so many different factors for each of us personally, but this is the general energy. There's this super intense feeling of I've gotta make this, you know, happen for myself. I've gotta have power in the situation. I've got to get that person to love me. I've got to get recognized this way. And if not, I'm going to, you know, there can be this really strong impetus to try to dominate other people while seeing ourselves as the victim. So we have the right to do that, because if I don't, it's, you know, eat or be eaten, you know, kill or be killed kind of energy. And you've got to ask yourself, you know, this, again, this is so instinctual, so primal, so basic. We have other faculties to work with, like our witnessing mind. That's the nice thing about being human, is we have an intellect and we have the ability to step back and say, huh, what am I doing? Do I really need this person? Is it true that I need this person's love? Is it true that this person's going to hurt me if I don't make sure that I have myself in a position where, you know, I'm the boss? Or is it true that I'm going to completely lose power in the situation? Is it true that I'm not going to survive if I don't get this, that, and the other thing, you know, these things met? If I don't do that this weekend, if I don't do that right now, I, you know, again, I'm trying to speak to a bunch of different ways that this can manifest for all of us. But I hope that you're getting the general thrust of what I'm talking about in terms of this energy. And definitely leave in the comments, you know, if you want to share, leave in the comments about what's going on for you, either here on the YouTube or on my Facebook page, because I love hearing what's happening for you. I like when people participate. It's a cool thing about the internet, is that there's that ability, you know, for us to do that from far away. I'm here in Ireland, you guys. So let's see what else we've got going on. I feel like that's the dominant, you know, aspect that's going on right now. Mars in Cancer. I promised that I would talk about what Mars in Cancer is, and I just remembered to do that. Mars in Cancer really wants to protect the homestead, really wants to protect the family unit, protect the covering, the cauldron, the house, the structure around us that keeps the private life contained and keeps our privacy and keeps our tribe together and keeps ourselves rooted. Cancer gets very upset when she feels that her nest is being fucked with in any way. Pluto, Mars. Mars is in Cancer. Mars, the warrior god, in the sign of home and nurturing and nutrition and mother and, you know, Mars in an opposition with Pluto may bring out feelings of having that threatened. And that's what all the hubbub is about. You know, you are threatening my innermost sanctuary, so I now have the right to fuck you up. That may or may not be true. Sometimes that's true, sometimes it's not. It's something to examine, especially if you're fighting with somebody you love. That's where this gets bad, because we tend to do that in our most intimate relationships. Again, this is an opposition. If you've been in an intimate relationship, you know that these one-on-one relationships are the place that we tend to spar the most, because we care the most. They do feel life and death, you know? And that's why we get into it. With the people that we love the most, we hurt them sometimes. That's why it's really good to step back and say, all right, let me take my teeth out of this. Let me take my investment. Let me ask me, why am I so invested in things going this particular way? What is it that I think I'm gonna lose if it doesn't? And why does that matter? Why is that, what would be so bad about losing such and such? Would I survive? Am I okay? You know, why is this so important? What need am I actually trying to meet? where does it come from? When did I have this feeling first in my life? And am I reacting to that still? This is a great opportunity for like super uber healing, you know, deep stuff. So Venus moves into Gemini on July 4th. That's going to be good, you know, for those of you who live in the United States. That's going to be pretty good for socializing on that holiday. Definitely throughout, you know, when Venus moves into... Venus is all about social relationships and how we interact with other people, how we cooperate, things like that. So Venus moving into Gemini, you know, I hate to have her move out of Taurus because she's so happy there. It's her home turf. She gets to, like, be fed grapes and eat chocolate and drink wine and feel good and relationships go well and all the physical aspects of relationship are enhanced and, you know, the sensual piece to how we relate to other people is made easier. Now she moves into this mental sign, not a bad placement for Gemini. She likes to flirt in this sign. She wants to flirt with ideas and words. And this is a very mental, this is Venus becoming a sapiosexual, right? One who's attracted to intelligence. So she goes into Gemini, but before that, she goes through the last part of Taurus, you know, and, you know, completes that process where she, you know, so enjoy these last couple days of her being in Taurus with, you know, again, eat good food, have, you know, some good wine, do things that are enjoyable and pleasurable, you know, and then she moves into Gemini where it becomes more social and it becomes more mental. And things get a little lighter. She likes being in Gemini. She's kind of butterfly-like in Gemini. But she's also, and really Gemini is the sign of the lover's card in the tarot. So this is where Venus also gets into choice-making when she's in Gemini. So there may be, you know, as she transits through Gemini, there may be choices to make in our love relationships, you know. And we get like a feeling of I would like some more variety in things, that the simple stuff isn't quite as satisfying when she moves into Gemini. Now it's time to try some new stuff, you know. So what else happens? Mercury moves into, on July 5th, into Leo. And that is, do I have that correct? I do. And that is, wait a minute. What do I have here? Yeah, on July 5th. I have my things all screwed up here. So Mercury into Leo, July 5th, mind moving into a more inspired, fiery place. So he comes out of Cancer, where he's more emotionally based, and moves into Leo, where he's more about creative inspiration. And definitely a little more bombastic in the way he's speaking about things, especially himself, you know. And this is a Mercury that wants to inspire, wants to create, wants to discover himself or herself in the sign of Leo. It's a great placement for Mercury also. So this isn't, it's probably a little bit less problematic than Cancer. So that's kind of good. So we'll find ourselves shifting into, with Mercury moving into Leo and with Venus moving into Gemini, we'll probably find ourselves feeling a little bit more social, even with this background of Mars and Pluto going on. We'll find ourselves wanting to be a little bit more social, a little bit more outgoing. These are two, you know, Gemini and Leo are both more extroverted signs. So we'll move out of a place where we, you know, feel like attending to ourselves more on an emotional level and a physical level, and move into more of an exchange of thought and inspiration and creativity and that kind of thing. So that's kind of good. All right. And then Mercury also makes a square aspect to Uranus. So we might get some surprises, and that's actually on July 4th. So that's fireworks right there. Mental fireworks, certainly. So yeah, Mercury getting into that square with Uranus, there might be some new ideas that present themselves. They might be a little shocking, they might be a little upsetting, especially when we're feeling a little tender because of the Mars-Pluto thing. So just try to stay open. Okay, great, new stuff, awesome. What can I do with this? If I don't know right now, fine, I'll put this away, I'll deal with it later when I feel more like it, you know? So definitely surprises in travel too. So if you're traveling that weekend, just, or that week, this week, you know, or around July 4th, just expect things to not quite go the way that you thought they would. You know, no matter what, how you plan, Mercury rules short journeys, squaring Uranus, you know, just keep your eyes on the road. Do not drink and drive, because that could be an accident, you know, sudden whoops, you know, just make sure you're taking care and paying attention. And so I'm going to pick our tarot card for this week. Ready, guys? Here we go. Tarot card. I don't like that one. This here. Eight of Cups. All right. So, you know, sometimes we have to walk away from stuff that's not emotionally satisfying. You know? And the Eight of Cups says that there may be an aspect to this Pluto, Mars, transit that the stuff that does come up for you, you know, pay attention to where you are dissatisfied, you know, in your situations. Because if you're not getting what you should be out of a situation, you might need to walk away from it. It might be time to walk away to, again, take your teeth out of a situation and say, you know what, this isn't quite the right thing for me. You know, especially as the moon goes into being full here, this is like feeling like, you know, I've kind of been here, done that. I'm not invested in this anymore. You know, the Eight of Cups can be a card of disappointment too. So sometimes when people don't measure up to what we want them to be, we go on the attack because we're trying so desperately to get them to be different so that we can continue to have them in this placement in our lives that we would like them to remain in. And why can't you change? And why can't you step up? And why can't you be the mom or the dad that I want you to be? And we really have to look at people the way that they are. And either we can love them the way that they are, unconditionally, just as they are, without trying to change them, get them to do such and such, get them to stop doing such and such. You know, we can teach each other and we can learn and we can grow, you know, but we can't make somebody else something that they're not. And so the Eight of Cups is kind of, you know, a signal that sometimes, you know, and also to win a business deal, you have to be able to walk away from a business deal, a deal of any kind. You have to be willing to walk away from it. You know, again, take your claws out of it. Take your claws out of the people that you love that you're trying to make be something, or the job that you're in, try to make it be what you, you know. So this is this energy, and there's this angel, this little winged creature coming out. I don't know if you can see that, out of the dark cave there. And that's just, to me, this little, it's not an angel, it's a bird, it's a dove. That's peace. I don't know if you can see it. You know, that sometimes letting go is the strongest act of love we can do, because that's a form of acceptance. It's saying, okay, you know what? I don't love you the way that you are. I can't, because, or I love you, but I can't live with you the way that you are. And then you stop attacking that person. And then that gives that little dove an opportunity to come out of the cave. And then there's hope for new things to emerge. And there's peace. And there's nonviolence in your situation. Pluto Mars can be so violent. And when it gets geared up, and we want to make sure that we're not being violent toward the people in our lives or toward ourselves by trying to contort ourselves into something so that we don't have to walk away, and so we can make this things okay and stay in a situation that's not really the greatest for us. So on that note, this report is over. And I thank you for showing up and watching this, and let me know your thoughts. Come to my webpage and get a reading with me, and subscribe to this channel. And also, become a patron. I always want to thank the patrons that bring this reading to you, because this is how this these New Wheat Reports, these free New Wheat Reports that are due out every Friday, they come to you because of the generosity of the patrons on my Patreon page, April's Astrology, patreon.com. I post things just for patrons on that page. Please do become a patron and support this New Wheat Report. Okay, take care. We'll see you next week. Bye now.